You see, there are 7 musical scales. I think it is the same in the occidental music also. Is it? The 7 tones. Is it? The first tone is a complementary to the 7th tone. And again, there is the its 7th tone on the 3rd gamut. So, the supplementary nature of the 1st and the 7th tone, that forms the content of the positive zero. Yes, exactly, it is. Yes, yes. In fact, it was popular in the music of all nations in the ancient days. It is lost in the nations now, and only in the Indian nation it is existing, continuing. Because luckily they could just maintain the continuity of the tradition in music. I think there is one occult reason for this. Among the 7 magnetic points of the earth globe, among the 7 magnetic points of this earth globe, the area where India exists is one. They are now not inhabitable. The one is North Pole and the other is South Pole. Jalkul has given in his books the location of the 7 magnetic points of the earth. Jerusalem area is another point. Now it is in hotbed. And according to the occult history of humanity, the piece of land that includes the area from Central Asia to India, that is the oldest piece of land surviving at present. Central Asia. From Central Asia to India. And it was the place where the present wave of humanity first started. This is called the 5th root race of humanity. And therefore, that place has some continuity of thought and tradition and consciousness. All the other places, they were submerged and emerged from the oceans many times. That may be the reason. See, we have the aspect what we vaguely call nature. We should try to understand through meditation what we exactly mean by the word nature. Then we will understand what World Mother is. For example, everyone has his own individual nature, which is different from the nature of another individual. And under that, there is what is called the basic human nature, which is common to all human beings. Under that, there is what is called the nature of the living beings, which is common to human beings, animals and plants. Under that, there is what is called the planetary nature of our earth. When we are able to feel that nature, that is what is called World Mother. In the scriptures, it is called the Mother Earth. In the Greek mythology, it is called Mother Ceres. In Indian scriptures, it is called the Goddess Earth. It is equal to the 5th plane of consciousness according to the divisions of Jalkul. That is what we call the nirvanic plane, or what we call the soul consciousness of humanity. That is what the masters say, the World Mother. No, the layers are like ladders. They will not change. We will become subtler and subtler when we go up the ladder. because these layers belong to the universal creation. They are fixed formula. There is no question of those entities becoming finer. It is only the atoms of the earth globe that become finer and finer until all are vibrating with the fullest consciousness realized. In the meanwhile, these consciousnesses, they travel through so many stages. And these stages are what we call the layers of consciousness. If you take a ladder, for example,
Amen.
And persons going up the ladder, the persons change their levels, the ladder never changes the level. Very happy to be with you once again after 1 year. And I feel once again fresh to have our gatherings here. The subject you have chosen is very intricate. It requires a more attentive and intricate study on the part of the listeners, about whom I am very much confident. The six keys and the seventh, the text of the scriptures, forms the common application technique to all the scriptures in the world. First of all, let us try to understand what a scripture is and how scriptures came into existence. This requires an inevitable introduction, without which we are apt to understand scriptures according to our own way of understanding. But the scriptures have their own way in which we have to understand. For example, many people understand the scriptures from the light of some religion. No doubt, through many centuries, religions are much benefited by scriptures. And each standard religion has taken a scripture as its standard. And on the basis of the scripture, the religions developed. And remember that the scriptures are much older than any religion in this world. Religions try to explain scriptures to us, but in trying to do so, they explained the scriptures in their own way, not in the way of the scriptures completely. So to say, the religious study of scripture is bound to be a bit narrow than the study which we are expected to do. For example, if we take the Old Testament and the Gospel, if we understand it through Christianity, we will understand only very little about it. But if we try to understand it directly, we can understand the splendor of the scripture, and also we can understand the light of the Lord, that is the Christ, far greater than Christianity. Same thing with every scripture also. If we take the Indian scriptures, they are explained by Hinduism and Buddhism. We try to understand them through Buddhism or Hinduism, we will understand only very little, because these scriptures are much older than Hinduism or Buddhism. So if we try to understand the scriptures independently, yeah, we will be able to understand the whole splendor of the scriptures, the technique of their composition, and the technique with which we are supposed to approach all these things will be understood. So, let us try to understand to which date the scriptures belong. If we imagine the days when the first group of human beings were there on this earth, it is not so scientific to understand that they were primitive. Because the very fact that they were created by some intelligences, and the very fact that such an intelligent process like evolution was taking place, that the mineral, plant and the animal kingdom was conducted without the help of the human being, we can understand the infallible intelligence of nature's intelligences. And if we examine the achievements the human being has made, we also understand the intelligence that is embedded in the human constitution and the capabilities that are embedded in the human being. And also we can understand the intelligences that have created the human being. These intelligences of nature, who have made the atoms on this earth, the plants, the animals and the human beings, they are responsible for the wisdom the human beings received. The first group of human beings were in direct contact with these intelligences of creation, whom we call the beings of the Deva kingdom. And they enjoyed the direct presence of the Devas. Of course, even to us also, the presence of these Devas is as much as it was to the primitive human beings. But we feel very, very less than those people felt. The clarity and the intensity with which the ancient human beings felt their presence was much more than what we feel. For the simple reason, we are very busy in our own way.
Austin.
We are always busy creating our own environment with the many positive and negative achievements. We are busy with our strong creations as well as the many pollutions that are killing us. And we are busy in making our time busy and finding wonderful that we have no time or leisure for our own thing. The result is we do not remember that nature exists as much as we remember that you and I exist. If at all we remember nature, at the most we remember once in a day or once in 2 days or 3 days. That too for a few moments. Even though we are in contact with nature, we are very busy in our mind. Though nature is making its presence felt by us, though the beauty of nature is imposing its presence upon us, though the devas of sunrise and sunset, the day and the night, the consciousness and the sleep, they are all working with us, though they are making us respire and make our hearts beat when we are awake or when we are asleep, yet we have no time to remember them. Just as we have no time to remember that we are breathing, unless there is a blockage in the nasal passages. For this reason, the presence of these devas is not so much to us as it was to the ancient human beings. We are intelligent in our own way, and we cannot realize that our intelligence is the secondary and the tertiary result of the intelligences of nature. The secondary and the tertiary of the intelligences of nature. We start with our own intelligence to do our own actions. And as long as we are successful, we remember only of our intelligence and our own programming. And unless we fail, we do not begin to think of other forces. But there are human beings who are reasonably trained in the right direction, enough to feel the presence of the intelligence of nature, to establish a contact with them, to try to know the language of these devas, and to learn the alphabet of their language, and to know the difference between the man-made languages and the language of the devas.
Und?
The language of the devas is common to all human beings, irrespective of the language we speak. Whereas our languages differ from each other, so that an Indian cannot understand a German, and you Germans cannot understand an Indian speaking. But the language of the devas is common to all if we can understand. For example, if we are pleased, we smile and laugh sometimes. You can't laugh in German or in English. Everyone has to laugh in the same language. When the child is hungry, he cries and weeps.
Yeah.
He cannot cry or weep in French or German or English. He has to cry only in one language, whether it is dog or human being. When there is sorrow, the being can be sorry only in one language. When the living being is happy, it can be happy only in one language, called happiness or satisfaction, whether it is a dog or a cat or a cow or a human being. This is only an example of the language of the devas, which is different from the narrow human man-made language. Now imagine the first batch of human beings who were not very much well equipped with man-made language. They had only the language given by the devas. And when they spoke to each other, they spoke only in the language of the devas. Just as even today, dogs talk to dogs, cats talk to cats, and a bull talks to a cow. Like that, the human beings also talked in the same way. And the devas transmitted wisdom to the human beings in a more significant way than we understand it now. So, about the creation, and about the human being, about the environment, about time and space, about the solar year and the lunar year, about heaven and earth, about sun, moon and the planets and stars, about all these things, the intelligences of nature have transmitted their language to the first batch of human beings. And the first beings received it directly. That was the origin of the scripture. It was an oral tradition. If you can just understand the concept of the first human being, he was not yet in his physical body. From him, the physical human beings were created. He was in his subtler bodies. For example, the etheric and the astral bodies, the mental, the buddhic, etc. He was not having his physical body. And he was hermaphrodite in the beginning. From him, the first human being male and the first human being female came out. And from them both, the physical human beings came. So it was this first hermaphrodite human being who is called Manu in the scriptures, from which the present word man etymologically derives. The first Manu came on this earth as the prototype of humanity. And he was not completely an individual.
he was present to himself both as an individual and also as a group of devas, because he was not yet an individual completely. In the scriptures he is called Manu, the son of the self-born creator. The creator does not mean God, but it is the next stage of God. Many people mistake that God is the creator, but God is the background, but not the creator. From God the background, the secondary God comes, who is called the God the creator, who is described as four-faced, or the cross within the square. From him, the Manu comes. So the creator is called self-born from the background God, who is called the God omnipresent. So we have now three concepts of God according to the script. One is God omnipresent. In Sanskrit, he is called Narayana. He is the background. Two is the creator, Brahma the four-faced. The third, son of the creator, the Manu, who is described as hermaphrodite. He is also called the first Manu, because from him six Manus will evolve in the form of six other races of humanity. So there will be seven waves of humanity through very big periods of time. Each period is called an interval of Manu, or Manvantara in Sanskrit. Manvantara means an interval between two Manus. So we have seven Manus starting from the first Manu, and another set of seven Manus. So we have in total 14 Manus in one unit creation. This total period is called one kalpa, or one unit creation. So we are talking about the first Manu as the hermaphrodite. From him the first oral tradition of the scriptures came. It is about him we study in the opening pages of the Old Testament, whom we call Adam and Eve. It is described, from his rib she was created. That means he was hermaphrodite. The male and the female potentialities in one existence. In Sanskrit, he is said to have bifurcated. He became two longitudinally. The one is called the husband Manu. The second part is called the wife, whose name is Shatarupa, means hundreds of forms. Shata means center, hundred. Rupa means form. So from his wife, he had hundreds of forms of living beings. At the end of the creation, at the end of the evolution of these forms, he had the human body. So this is the tradition of the first prototype of the human being. So he gave to the human beings the first lessons of wisdom, and the human beings received them and developed them and kept as oral tradition. Not only because they had no writing or script in those, but also after the human beings discovered the script and writing, they maintained only oral tradition. Just as even today, the real scriptural tradition is only oral tradition, because the scriptures can be transmitted only orally, and it is not at all possible to transmit through any book. You can ask me, now we are having the many books of scriptures. Yes, you have the books of scriptures. But the scriptures are only with people. Transmitted from person to person. Never through a book. Through a book, you can know everything about scripture. But you can never receive a scripture. About a scripture is different from a scripture. To know about a scripture, just as a book on magnetism can teach you everything about a magnet, except a magnet. If you place a piece of iron on the table and rub it with that book on magnetism,